Gilbert was found in a lake in Bedfordshire last May. Two brothers and two women deny murder. Mark Worthington is at Luton Crown Court now. Mark.
Well, Sophie, Michael Gilbert was a vulnerable adult who, according to the prosecution, was kept against his will for a number of years in a state of terror. Today here at Luton Crown Court, when those accused of being his captors and his killers went on trial, the jury were warned that much of the evidence would be shocking.
Michael Gilbert, 26 years old, but as powerless as a child. With no close family of his own, he was taken in by a Luton household, where, say the prosecution, he was kept as a slave, beaten and murdered. This is the house where the prosecution say Michael Gilbert was forced to do the chores, and where he ultimately died. The court heard that while his alleged captors were living here, Michael Gilbert was kept prisoner in the house and subjected to gratuitous and sustained violence. These are the two women accused of his murder. 21-year-old Nicola Roberts in the red, alongside Natasha Oldfield, who's 29. They were followed into court today by the mother of their two co-accused, the brothers James and Robert Watt. The prosecution barrister, Stuart Trimmer QC, told the jury he was kept, amongst other things, to take his benefit money. He was abused and assaulted in reality for entertainment. Michael Gilbert's dismembered body was found submerged in Bedfordshire's Blue Lagoon in May last year. The jury heard he died from a combination of injuries inflicted by several different people. Injuries he didn't tell anyone about because he was afraid of suffering even worse.
This is a complicated case involving several different defendants, and there will now be many weeks of harrowing evidence as the allegations against the accused are outlined in graphic detail. It's expected to be April before there's a verdict.
Mark, thank you very much. The pop star Cheryl Cole has announced that she is separating from her husband Ashley Cole. She arrived back in England this morning after going to America following allegations that her husband, the England and Chelsea footballer, has again been unfaithful. Cheryl Cole, seen here performing last week at the Brits, married Ashley Cole in 2006. And they've had one of the most high-profile show business marriages. Let's get more now from our entertainment correspondent, Lisa Mzimba. Just explain a bit more about these allegations then.
Well, over the last few weeks, there have been repeated allegations that Ashley Cole has been unfaithful to Cheryl with a number of women, resulting, of course, in lots of press speculation that their four-year marriage was in serious trouble. Some of those reports centred around messages, photos, allegedly received by a number of women.
And their marriage that has become one of the most sort of famous, hasn't it, showbiz marriages
around.
Absolutely.
They are one of the most high-profile marriages, couples in the country. Ashley, Chelsea footballer, England footballer, Cheryl has, though, eclipsed him since then. She's, of course, a member of the band Girls Aloud, but she really has become more and more popular over the years. Again, actually following more allegations of infidelity, she really captured the public hearts even more. She was made a judge on Simon Cowell's very popular The X Factor, and since then she's gone on to have a solo career, a number one single, and during all the furore about what's been happening over the last few weeks, she again endeared herself to the public by performing at the Brit Awards. After that, she flew to America but returned this morning when we got this announcement, and I think with everything that's been talked about over the last few weeks, very few people are surprised by this afternoon's news.
She has asked for privacy, though, hasn't she?
She has asked for privacy at this time, and we've had no comment from Ashley Cole's side at the moment.
OK, Lisa Mzimba, thank you very much. The time is coming up to 6:15, our top story tonight. The bomb blast in Newry. Politicians vow not to let it set back the peace process. And coming up, the sculptures of Henry Moore, why we may have to get used to seeing them indoors.
They are best appreciated where they're meant to be in the landscape, but not all of them are where they should be.
Coming up, all the entertainment news on E24, including more reaction to the news. Cheryl Cole is to split from her footballer husband, Ashley. What could it mean for her career? And it was Naomi Campbell's big night at the Elle Style Fashion Awards. Found out why in 15 minutes.
Toyota has admitted it took too long to deal with safety issues, which led to the recall of 8.5 million vehicles worldwide. The head of Toyota in the US, James Lentz, said that they failed to promptly analyze and respond to information provided. Adam Brooks has sent this report from Washington.
America's Toyota dealers were in Congress today in support of their battered brand.
We stand unequivocally with Toyota.
But elsewhere in Congress, the assault continued. The formidable Congressman Henry Waxman, he's accused Toyota of misleading Americans about just how serious were the problems with its car's accelerators.
Toyota failed its customers and the government neglected its responsibilities.
And Toyota's head of American operations, James Lentz, was here too, readying an apology to Congress and an admission that Toyota's response had fallen short. But still, the stories are strange and horrifying. In California, a Toyota Camry inexplicably plunged over a cliff. Was this a problem with the accelerator?
Man went up to park his car in the parking lot, looked like he came to a complete stop, and then just flew over the edge.
The driver survived, his wife died. The model he was driving, reportedly, was not part of any recall. And this, the tape of a 911 call from a man in a speeding Toyota.
We're in trouble.
The rest is too disturbing to play.
Okay. So important voices in the US Congress are now accusing Toyota and the US government of not doing enough to ensure that Toyotas still on the road are safe. Toyota, for its part, has now admitted being slow and unresponsive as complaints about safety started to come in.
Worldwide, 8.5 million Toyotas have now been recalled for safety problems. 5.5 million in the US, 1.8 million in Europe, and of those, more than 188,000 in the UK. And so tomorrow, the head of Toyota, Akio Toyoda, will face questioning in the US Congress too. He, we're told, will suggest that Toyota expanded too fast and that safety may have suffered. What an admission that'll be from this industrial titan. Adam Brooks, BBC News.
Let's talk now to Adam Brooks. The head of Toyota in the US is about to start speaking. What are we expecting him to say?
Well, the first thing he's going to try to do is reassure Congress and Americans that Toyota is on top of this problem. He's going to say that if your Toyota car was recalled, Toyota knows how to fix any potential problems with it. Congress isn't so sure. There's been a lot of questioning today around whether or not it might be a problem in the electronics of the car that's causing these accelerators allegedly to stick, rather than the mechanics. Toyota is still saying today, no, don't worry. If you take your Toyota back in to get fixed, we know how to fix it and to make sure that it's safe.
It's going to be quite a moment tomorrow when the global president speaks.
It is. It's going to be remarkable. He'll speak to Congress through an interpreter. He's come all the way from Japan. Congress had to get on the phone and persuade him to come. But he's going to admit to Congress, we're told, that perhaps Toyota grew too fast. And perhaps these safety problems was because, and I quote now, they started getting their priorities wrong. Sophie.
Adam, thank you very much. A teenage girl who murdered a pensioner after a row about a borrowed cigarette has been ordered to serve at least 14 years in jail by the High Court in Edinburgh. Nicole Early was 16 when she attacked her neighbour Anne Gray in her home near Lochgelly in Fife. The makers of the heartburn remedy Gaviscon have been accused of abusing their dominant position as a supplier to the NHS. The Office of Fair Trading inquiry, which followed a BBC investigation, says Reckitt Benckiser tried to restrict competition. The company says it acted within the letter of the law. The owner of Portsmouth Football Club has said it will go into administration if a new buyer isn't found by Friday. The Hong Kong businessman, Balram Chun Rai, is in talks with four different groups about a takeover, but admits it's unlikely a deal will be done in time. The Liberal Democrats say there is still a lending crisis in Britain which is hampering the recovery. Their Treasury spokesman, Vince Cable, has called on the government to force banks bailed out by the taxpayer to lend more money to small businesses. He said that RBS and Lloyds were falling short of legally binding commitments. But tonight, the banking industry has accused him of playing politics. Our chief economics correspondent, Hugh Pym, has the details.
The economy may be inching its way out of recession, but there are dark clouds on the horizon. Some home buyers are still struggling to get loans. Figures today showed business lending falling in January. Today, a familiar face in this debate came up with his latest idea. Vince Cable of the Liberal Democrats said the government should simply make state-controlled banks lend more money.
The Chancellor has got to be much firmer in setting out their objectives, key to which is supporting the British economy, supporting the small, medium-sized companies, without which we're not going to get growth and recovery.
The banks bailed out by the taxpayer agreed firm lending commitments. Lloyds agreed to lend an extra £14 billion. RBS was committed to lend £25 billion more. Both now admit they've failed to meet the targets. They say there isn't demand for the loans. I put it to Mr. Cable that banks couldn't be forced to lend to unwilling borrowers.
Of course, that would be foolish. Of course, nobody's suggesting that banks should be required to lend money to borrowers who don't want it. That's not the issue. All the evidence, and we had the survey from the Institute of Directors last week, said 6 out of 10 of all businesses that they were in contact with say they cannot get capital to keep their businesses operating or expanding.